Hi, welcome back to Spider's Web. When last we spoke, I was spending time in beautiful Great Malvern, England. And today I am on the train leaving Malvern and headed back to London, and then I'll be taking another train to Purton, where I'll spend my last few days in England on this wonderful trip. It's a gorgeous day. The scenery on this train is absolutely beautiful. Gorgeous countryside. And I'm going to have a few more fun days with my friends. And I think I'll introduce you to a couple of my voice students. I'll talk to you in a minute.
I took a trip on a train and I thought about you. I passed a shadowy lane and I thought about you.
Hi, this is Spider again. Imagine that. Well, I'm back here in Purton, and I've been traveling around. And as I mentioned earlier in the other broadcast, that Purton is a very tiny village. It is a delightful English village, but there is such enthusiasm and so many people that are involved in the arts here. So right now I'm at the home of the Rowe family, and this is a whole family that are involved in music. And they're amazing. And I'm speaking to Thomas. So say hi, Thomas.
Hi, guys.
Hey, so you have been at three performances that I've done here over the past few years in Purton. And you're such a great audience member. I always love to hear your feedback after a show. And you are now not only a trumpet player, but a pianist.
Yes.
And you are involved in all kinds of music. So do tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, I started playing piano at 5 years old, and then I started trumpet about 10 years ago, when I was seven. However, I've always been involved in music, particularly at my current school. There's a massive music scene there. My mum got me involved in music. She's been going to a band called Hitchin' Light Orchestra since before I was born, so I've been going to all their concerts.
Wow.
And it's just the greatest band ever.
And so, your mom plays saxophone, right?
Yes.
And then your sister is involved in that too, right?
Yeah. So me and my sister have joined it recently. And Lizzie plays bass.
Yes, and does a little bit of singing. That's just starting.
Yeah, that's just starting.
I got to coach her a little bit and getting started in a tune she's going to do. So that was exciting.
Of course.
And I know that you trained in classical music and you love musical theatre.
Yeah. I just love everything about musical theatre.
And you're playing currently, you're working on Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum?
Yes.
And then right after that?
Right after that, we've got a pantomime in Bedford that I'm playing for.
Uh-huh.
And then the school production of West Side Story.
Wow. So you get to do two Sondheim things.
Oh, I'm really
Leonard
looking
Bernstein
forward to it.
And that's terrific. So your whole family, from the time you were very young, they were, well, except for your dad, all involved in Hitchin' Light Orchestra.
Yes.
And just tell a little bit about that.
It's an amazing community band. All ages, all abilities, all instruments, with no audition process. So
that's amazing.
You just rock up and it's there. And it's sort of, it's amazing because we rehearse in this tiny little primary school village hall.
Mm-hmm.
Not village hall, school hall. And yeah, we turn up and we have a blast and then we'll go down to the pub afterwards.
That sounds like a plan. That's great. And then you were also an enthusiast about musical theater scores. You were telling me that you and your friends love to see how many you can get a hold of and run through the piano scores on these.
So we sort of spend hours trawling through the internet trying to find the best piano vocal scores. And then we print them off and go into school and spend our free periods and lunch times in the music department. Sort of playing, having fun, jamming sometimes. And it's great fun.
Have you done any jazz? Have you tried anything with jazz?
Not with my musical theatre friends.
Uh-huh.
I've got a couple of friends that are really into jazz. So I've got a friend called Greg May, who is a pianist and a bassist.
Oh, that's great.
With a little bit of saxophone, and he adores it as well.
Excellent.
So we can make quite a good, he's also good friends with my sister, so we can make quite a good sort of piano, bass, saxophone, jamming session.
Fantastic. Well, tell me this, what will you do? Are you graduating soon, or was it next year or this year?
Yeah, so this at the end of this year.
End of this year.
Yeah.
What will happen next? Do we know?
I'm not going to follow music.
You're not?
No, I'm not.
That's what you think.
Oh. Well, yes, a lot of people have said that.
Uh-huh.
I love music and I keep it as a hobby, and I want to keep it as a hobby. It's never going to stop for me, but I'm going on to study ancient history at university. But one of the big so at the moment I'm looking around universities wondering where to apply to.
Right.
And one of the big considerations is how much music do they have?
Yes.
And that's why I'm looking at London, because everything is in London, and you've got to love it. All the musical theatre, all the jazz, all the classical.
That's wonderful. Perfect. Wow. Well, that's exciting. Well, Thomas, thanks for taking the time. And please keep the music in your life. I cannot imagine your life without music, not with this family.
Neither can I.
And thanks a million, and have a blast, and keep us posted.
Thank you, Spider.
Okay, babe. So I'm here with Julie, who just had her voice lesson. And we had a great time. I think she had fun. She looks like she's having fun. But I'm gonna say that Julie is gonna chat with me a little bit here and say hi, Julie, and tell us about what you do.
Hi, I'm I run a children's choir. I run this before school on a Thursday morning. Find children very receptive at that time in the morning. They like singing. We have a large repertoire of songs.
And it wakes them up, right?
And it wakes them up. I like to vary the songs I have in my choir. I have some folk songs, I have some pop songs, some Disney songs, some of the Beatles.
And that keeps them interested.
It keeps them interested. I let them pick some of the songs, and I volunteer some of the songs.
And I love what you were saying about how some of the students, they get to a certain age and peer pressure makes them drop out.
Yeah, they get to, I think through peer pressure at school. I know children do like singing, and they are easily persuaded by others that this isn't the thing to do, which is a shame.
Oh, it is, yeah.
I know deep down they like singing.
Yeah, and they hopefully will get back to it. But
Hopefully we'll get back to it.
But it's pretty exciting that you're there for them and creating this good space. And then you were talking about the repertoire, like that. Oddly, if you don't label something, they may end up falling in love with it.
because I work mainly with folk songs, I never say to them, this is a folk song we're going to learn. I just introduce the song. And oddly enough, all the songs I know they like are the folk songs. If I'd said this is a folk song, the shutters would have gone down thinking, oh, this is old-fashioned, I don't really want to learn this. But I let them listen to what the tune is and let them decide, do I like this song? Do I like the melody of this song? And do I like the words? Do I like singing this song? And funnily enough, when they say, yeah, what we're going to sing first of all, we've learnt Molly Malone this year, and that is one of the songs they love the best. And
having
so learnt
cool.
it, I then say, well, that's a folk song. So it's you know, decide on the song, not the genre. That way you love to sing, because I know a lot of songs are built from older songs.
Absolutely, so, yeah, sure.
And there's a good basis of, in a folk song, of the basic chords build up.
Mm-hmm.
And you can work on a lot of things. It's a great choral song.
Oh, wait, just one more thing I want to ask you. You mentioned that it was your grandmother?
My grandmother was Welsh.
Yeah.
She died when I was pretty young, so I didn't know her for that long. But one of the things she taught me to say was the name of the long railway station in Wales. I will now say it over. Llanfair plithgwingi, golgera quindrobli, llantithilio, gogohoch. And she went through it syllable by syllable. And as a child, I found it absolutely fascinating to learn this long, if not just to impress my friends.
It's impressing me right now.
But I've also discovered that in that long, and a lot of Welsh words, the emphasis on vowels is always there.
Mm-hmm.
And I reckon this is why Welsh people make very good singers, because their language is filled with pronouncing and stressing the vowels.
Oh, beautiful. Well, thanks so much, Julie, and I'm having a blast here, and we have much more partying to do. Okay. So I'm going to conclude this episode with one of the things that's always been so attractive to me going to London years ago. Oh boy, I shudder to think when. I went to school in London. It was part of my college curriculum, and I went there as a young theater student. And for years, I couldn't remember where on earth I stayed when I was there. Well, I got lost in London like I get lost everywhere. I have no sense of direction. And I'm in Hyde Park, and I'm walking around, and lo and behold, I came across the hotel where I had stayed. It was the Lancaster Gate Hotel, and it was next door to the Swan Pub. That's a very, very old pub in Hyde Park. And it's on Bayswater, and I took this beautiful long walk through Hyde Park. I even went up the staircase that I used to go to walk through Hyde Park as a young student, and walked all the way up to Selfridges and back. And it was a beautiful walk down memory lane, and it was very emotional, remembering a time when I was very, very young and hopeful. And things worked out pretty well, I think. But that's my little bittersweet parting message before I travel on to the last of my trip. Well, that was my trip to England. I had a wonderful time, and I'm going to be flying back to my hometown, Chicago. Keep having fun, and I will see you next time at Spider's Web.